the legendary, spectacular, thrillingly funny
Eddie Murphy. F*** you.
I told you that's my biggest regret is the stopping. Like, I used to just go and do it.
Right.
Stopping and letting that muscle atrophy.
Yes.
It's my only regret.
You don't like going up unless you really have something on stage. You know,
well, I wouldn't go out on tour without an act.
Right.
The hardest thing about getting back on stage again is when you don't have anything.
Right.
I don't have anything. That's like a scary thing. Then it got different. It got to where when I was working out stuff, it would be in the paper like the next day. They were on me too much during the creative process. I remember Joan Rivers' husband had died, and I went up at the Comedy Store and I did like some bit about, you know, because she used to do all these jokes about Edgar. Oh, that's it.
Yeah,
he had committed Rose, he had committed suicide. And
right.
I did some joke like, hey, you got tired of all them Edgar jokes. Some shit I said that was, you know,
right.
It wasn't cool. And it was in the paper the next day, and everyone was outraged. And,
right.
Joan was hurt, and I was like, that wasn't even a bit yet.
You know that you not doing stand-up drives people crazy. You know that, right?
The last time I saw Don Rickles, and Rickles was like maybe a month or two before he passed away, and he just went on and on and on like that. Like, you know,
really?
Like, you have to do stand-up again. You have to just went on and on about it. Like, wow. I'm going to do it again. It was
really?
Just, yeah, I just had to, you know, everything has to be right. You got to get up there and start working out.
Really?
I have to get up and work. The only way you could get like an act is I got to go to the clubs and work out. I'm going to do that again. I'm a careful man.
Yes, you are. But not in your comedy. You are definitely a fearless comedian.
Brothers act like they couldn't have been slaves back 200 years ago. It ain't like them motherfuckers like that shit. I wish I was a slave. I would fuck somebody up. Shit, tell me to bail some motherfucking cotton. I would have been on the street and shit. You would have came up and said, hey, yo, nigga, bail this cotton. I would say, suck my dick, master. Suck my motherfucking dick. That's right, I ain't bailing the motherfucker. It wasn't like that shit. The first dude that got off the boat said that shit. Bail that cotton. Fuck you, motherfucker. The other motherfucker said, we'll bail the shit. Just keep that shit over. Just keep that fucking shit away from me.
Then it started feeling more like work.
Well, because the money gets bigger.
Yeah,
and the fun gets smaller.
And
that's the problem. Comedy and money, to me, are antithetical. Because one of the things that makes things funny is when you don't have any money. I feel like when you add money to a project, you're tampering with the comedy. Because all of a sudden, we're building big things, taking time, taking the fun out of it.
And with a little pressure.
Yeah, a little pressure, a little cheap, a little sloppy.
Pressure. Like I said, when you get ready to go on stage and you just feel like...
Right, that little edge.
You gotta, that's crucial. You gotta put time in to make something happen, you know, that's worthwhile. And now you got so many options, it's like it seems hard to focus on something. So many options.
The lack of focus is why we have a lack of greatness.
Because everyone has so many options.
So many options.
I've seen niche comics that work a comedy club on a certain night and they kill there. And, you know, you kill on Wednesday, but then a regular crowd's coming in on Thursday and you can't even get a laugh.
Right.
You just work that niche.
Right.
And you don't think, hey, I want to be able to kill on Thursday. You just say, that I'm just killing every Wednesday is enough. More than anything, I want to kill all the time.
Yeah.
Like, I would love to kill and somebody had trouble following you after.
Yeah, yeah.
And they, all right, and the audience is still clapping. So, all right, okay now. Come on, one more time for so-and-so. I'd live for that.
Oh, that's so great.
Remember, I did Stevie Wonder on the show once. And black people lost their motherfucking minds. I had brothers rolling up on me going, hey, you the motherfucker I be doing Stevie Wonder? That shit ain't funny, motherfucker. Don't you never let me see you do that shit again. I'll fuck you up. Stevie Wonder's a musical genius.
You could fucking make a living, you know, making people laugh. You won. No one's there, so I'm not ever paying you another dime for do comedy again. You'd still go do comedy.
Right. There was nothing like those sets, right? when it would go well?
Nothing. And then three or four comics go to a diner.
Yeah.
And then it's just, you laugh till your throat hurts.
Yeah.
And I realized it was fun then, too. It wasn't like, oh, yeah, I didn't realize I was, like, I realized I was having a ball that night.
Right.
Because once you've made somebody laugh,
yeah,
you got them forever.
Right.
If you really made them laugh,
yeah,
they
yeah.
always think you're funny.
So why is it still so hard? I don't
That's
find
in
it...
your mind. That's in your mind.
It is in my mind.
It's in your mind.
I didn't feel
that
easy.
It's hard because you want to be good. That's why you're a great comic, because you always want to be good and you want it to be better. You want
right.
to get it. So that's in your mind where it's like the pressure and but the audience is just happy to see you.
I started doing stand-up when I was 15, so I had an interest in all this. I used to listen to everybody.
Where'd your fearlessness come from at 15 to be able to just say, I'm going to go do this?
I never even thought about it. You know, I look back on it now and I trip about how young I was, you know.
And I mean, you have kids that age. Can you imagine your kids just like, that's it, you're going out, you're doing
nah,
it? Like,
I was working bars when I was 15, 16. I was working bars, you know, and I didn't look at it as being fearless. I just wanted to get up there and be funny. Like, once I heard Richard Pryor, I was kind of like, okay, that's who I am. Because I was always the funny kid, and not just the class clown. I was never the class clown, because I was always kind of cool. So I was like the cool guy in the back that would say some shit, you know, with perfect timing, and I can do impressions of everybody. But from really early on, I was like the funny kid. And when I heard Richard Pryor, it was like, oh, okay, that's who I am. That's what I am. I'm that what that guy is. And that was 75, 76. So when I started getting on stage, it wasn't like I didn't look at it as it just being a brave thing. I just wanted to get up there and be funny like Richard Pryor.
Mm-hmm. A lot of youth yeah. and energy and
yeah.
just moving forward.
That's why I wasn't that's why there's no fear. You know, when you're young, you don't know. You know, you just go and do it. You take everything for granted. Mm-hmm. You know, on SNL, when I got on SNL, one of the reasons why I got on SNL the first season that the original cast left and they brought in a bunch of new people the first time they did that, and they hated it. They hated the show, and all the critics mm-hmm. hated it, and the people rejected the show, and it was horrible. And they said, the one bright light on the show is that kid Eddie Murphy. And the reason I was a bright light was because I wasn't even caught up in how grim it was, the show. I was just so happy to be on TV, and I was just so happy to be fun. So that came across. That came across. I wasn't like, oh, no, I'm on this horrible show that everybody hates. You know, I was right in the middle of that, but I was just so happy to be there. Mm-hmm. You know, I was getting laughs. Got off the couch, and I'm happy I got off the couch. And I'm getting ready to go start a Coming to America. Since I got off the couch, it was like, let me do some things that they want to see. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to do that. And I haven't been back to SNL in 35 years. I think I'm going to go host Saturday Night Live this year. Mm-hmm. And then next year, I'm going to tour, do some stand-up.
Well, I have to say.
And then back to the couch.
Back to the couch.
Yeah, after that run.
Well, the Mark Twain speech was amazing. I just watched it on YouTube when your acceptance speech for that. And it felt like, I was like, wait a minute, this could be something he could take. This is like a little bit of a set here. And you had everybody. When you hear that laughing and you hear there, everyone was responding and it was so funny and I'm laughing just watching it on YouTube. How does that feel when you walk off that stage?
That night I was like, oh, well, wow, okay, I could still do that. Because I didn't know what I was going to do. That was like, okay, you got to say something. So, like, you know, the night before that, I wrote something, my acceptance speech. And it was like, oh, you know, you could still... Nothing has changed except I just don't get up on the stage and do it. But the process of sitting down and putting it together, and it's like, oh, I could still do that. And it had been a while since I had just talked like that and got laughs and was like, oh, whoa, well, I remember that. Oh, okay, it's cool. That's when I started thinking, maybe I should get on stage and do some stand-up again.
How do you find the whole political correctness climate for stand-ups. A lot of them have gotten in trouble and end up apologizing and stuff. Does that give you any pause?
No, because back when I was doing stand-up, the word political correctness hadn't come up yet, but I had people picketing and talking shit and getting... I went through all of that shit back then, you know, so... It was always like that. I know you got to pick your shots now, the stuff that you say. You
know. Do you have nerves at all about the idea of going back on tour?
No, nervous. You know, when I think about doing stand-up, it's this, this is the perfect analogy. It's like if you go to the pool and the water cold, and somebody goes, oh, it's freezing. And you go, oh, you got it. And then you go, oh, before you jump in and you go, oh, the water's fucking cold. That's how I feel with stand-up. It's like I need it. It's like, oh, that feeling of, ooh, it's gonna be freezing when I first get in. But then, you know, that feeling just before you jump in the pool. That's not nervous or scared. That's just, you know, I know the water's cold. And Saturday Night Live, like I said, I hadn't been back there since, you know, 35 years ago. And I want to tour next year. So I kind of like, this is the perfect, even the Coming to America movie, this is like, I'm kind of bookending. Like, I didn't want if I never make another movie again, I didn't want the last movie I did to be something that wasn't funny. Last movie I did was about a guy that takes care of this woman who's dying of cancer. Like a serious...
Mr. Church.
Yeah, Mr. Church. It was like a serious movie.
Character,
yeah. And I didn't want to leave it. I love the movie, but I didn't want to leave it there because I'm the fuck you man. I'm the funny guy. So I wanted to do something really, really funny, you know.
You have such power, though, even when you're not funny, even when you're silent, you have a lot of power on screen.
Yeah, but people come to see me to laugh, though. They're not coming for me to be silent. You know, he's sure is powerful up there not talking, but I wish he'd say something funny. Look how powerful he is making those eggs. He could just make eggs and hold your attention. But I sure wish this motherfucker say something funny. God damn. I don't think there's any higher calling for an artist. There's nothing that can be compared to being, you make people laugh. To make people laugh, I know I'll take laughter over any type of entertainment. Over, you want to go see a tearjerker or you want to dance at a party, whatever. You want to see some romance or you want to laugh. You would rather laugh over anything. You know, and to have that, that's like a precious gift, you know.
I have thoroughly enjoyed hanging out with you and talking to you.
Cool. So we got all the important stuff. I'm the funniest man in the world. Mm-hmm. I started it all. Mm-hmm. I opened the doors for everybody. Mm-hmm. And don't start no shit. Mm-hmm. That's basically everything. Mm-hmm.